In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We Christians have a hard time not associating success with God's blessing. It just seems natural to believe that if someone is successful, if someone has all things going their way, if riches and fame, recognition and popularity seem to adorn their path through life, we just naturally assume God must be with that person. We tend to say they're blessed. And part of that picture usually includes some kind of a pretty perfect family to go along with the blessed person. Their family members may have faced some adversity, but they have surely overcome it. And they are inevitably a loving, bonded family with healthy dynamics shaped by the gospel. We tend to imagine that in a family in which faith in God is a key element, no one is trying to pin another family member to the wall with a spear. But the truth, as we hear this morning, is a lot more complex. And to its credit, the Bible is uncontrived enough to air the unwashed laundry right out there in the front yard. Indeed, one might be tempted to think that God's favorite vehicle for self-revelation and to accomplish God's work of moving the world toward its final consummation, one is tempted to think that God's favorite vehicle for this kind of work must be a dysfunctional family. Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, Noah and his daughters, Abraham and Agar, Jacob and Esau, Joseph and his brothers, David and Bathsheba. I didn't have to think very long to come up with that list. Fortunately, the story of God in creation does not stop at once upon a time, but continues, including us as well. None of us should think ourselves exempt from life in the kingdom of God just because all is not well within our families. Nor should we ever cease from working to heal and make whole that which is broken. But we may take some comfort from the witness of Scripture to the determination of God to work with whatever it is that we bring to the table. In the reading from the Old Testament this morning, Saul's jealousy, his envy of David, who had killed his 10,000s while Saul claimed only 1,000. Even Saul's son falls in love with this ruddily handsome youth who has caught the eye of God as well. Saul's envy of David drives him to attempt to remove David by sending him into battle, hatching a plot that David will himself later use when faced with the dark side of his own oversized ego. It is complex. It is frightfully honest. It is Holy Scripture. May I hasten to point out that the Bible is not an instruction manual for life, at least not in the way we usually think of instruction manuals. There's no claim that everything in it is state-of-the-art for a perfect life. Indeed, at times it goes out of its way to tell us how not to do it. We cannot and should not use it like we would use a manual describing the installation of a dishwasher, both of which at times are equally confounding to me. It is, on the other hand, an incredibly honest and inspired reflection on the journey that we are on with the Creator of the cosmos. Like the journey itself, it is complex. Saul, in my view, is trying his best to impose a simplicity, I win, you lose, on the journey with God that simply does not carry the day. At first, perhaps, it may not seem much better if we move to the gospel. My first impression is that Jesus this morning in the gospel may have been showing off just a bit. Maybe he was just a little upset about being awakened, though I wonder who could really sleep through a storm in the back of a boat. On the other hand, if you began life as an infant, and that life included weeks of riding on the back of a donkey in a basket, as your parents sought asylum in Egypt, you might find the wave-induced movement of a small boat somehow comforting. I admit it's all speculation. What is reported is that Jesus was asleep in the back of the boat. Speaking of speculation, the fancy word for speculation on why it is that bad things happen to good people in a world made by an all-powerful, all-loving God. The fancy word for that kind of reflection is theodicy. We rejoice that Jesus responds to the fear of the disciples by drawing on his unique relationship with creation. But just a few moments of reflection can leave us wondering why he did not just prevent the storm in the first place. Or at least, that's where theodicy takes us. Here again, though, the honesty of Scripture is remarkable. The disciples, confronted with his ability to still the wind and the waves, the disciples respond not with worship. They do not fall down on their knees and praise him. They respond instead with a kind of fear that's called awe, and they step back just a bit. For what it's worth, it seems to me to be a holy kind of fear, something we could use a bit more of in these times. We still insist on running this world on our own oversized hubris, when a healthy fear of God, given the poor job we've done as regents of God, might be a better response. The waves and the winds are tossing our little boats a lot these days. Funny thing is, I know all the arguments of theodicy for why God allows it, and they are insightful, they are helpful. Some are more complex than others, but when you get right down to it, when the going really gets rough, they all say the same thing. It's time to remember the guy asleep in the back of the boat. Maybe he was never asleep. Maybe he was just waiting. I know his answer is not always as clear as it was that day in the boat, but I know that he answers. In faith, we open our worst moments to God's healing spirit and find in God and in faith the path and the strength to live another day. There is one funny thing in this story, having been around sailboats all my life. It's what the gospel says happened next. did you notice? A complete dead calm. That's not exactly a sailor's dream come true. We humans are, no doubt, the bane of God's existence. I wonder if they woke him back up and said, hey, could we have a little breeze? The theodicy thing is also woven through the reading from Paul's second letter to the Christians in Corinth. Paul, by most claims, is walking about as close with God as anyone ever has. Yet his life is one difficult thing after another. Or as the poet Edna St. Vincent Millay would observe, it's one thing over and over. But Paul affirms that what matters is that he remains on the journey with God. The man in the stern for Paul is neither sleeping nor inactive. Paul's confidence, his lack of anxiety, as he observes in another place, that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Paul's consistent confidence was a fruit of his relationship with God that arose from his encounter with the risen Lord. Indeed, as we see again this morning, such confidence is lacking in the lives of the disciples until after the resurrection. New life takes root, not on the windswept hilltop with a cross and dark clouds hovering, but rather in the garden outside an empty cave at sunrise. There's a lot to consider in these readings. David catches the eye of God and his path is ascending in this moment. But it will not always be so. Yet he is never completely abandoned by God. The disciples live to cross the lake again, and one of them manages for a moment to replace fear with godly confidence, briefly transcending the elements. But that same one will later come to deny that he ever knew Jesus. And one who persecuted believers becomes the example for all believers in their journey in God, exuding a confidence that seems to hold him more than he holds it. It is complex. It is honest. Centuries later and centuries ago from us, an Englishman whose name we do not know, perhaps summed it all in three simple verses. To see thee is the end and the beginning. Thou carriest me and thou goest before. Thou art the journey and the journey's end. Or as our friend, the disciple Peter, put it when Jesus asked if he wished to leave, Peter responded, Lord, to whom would we go? You alone have the words of eternal life.